Nathan, I found a movie. It's called Battletruck.
What? Battletruck? What's Battletruck?
Mate, it's battle and truck. What more do you need?
We're talking trash about trash, right?
Oh, you better believe it. What is there to say about a movie like this? You know what you're going to get.
Yeah, exactly. There's going to be a battle and a truck.
But like a lot of low-budget films, this also has an alternate title that's almost as great. In certain regions, this one is known as Warlords of the 21st Century, which makes me think of so many cheap Italian films like The New Barbarians, Warriors of the Wasteland.
Yeah, exactly. It's like all those, yeah, post-apocalyptic movies. No, I would have run with Battletruck.
I actually picked this movie for us to review on the title alone. It has that same blunt magic as something like Future Kick, which we've reviewed in the past.
But unlike Future Kick, this is actually half decent.
Oh, it's light years ahead of something like Future Kick.
Yeah, no time was I bored during this film.
That being said, this doesn't mean Battletruck is some kind of work of fine art. I mean, unless you're weirdos like us who love this kind of thing.
Bullshit. Derivative. That I love. I absolutely love.
But yeah, Battletruck is still a B-film through and through, which is why there's maybe a few familiar elements for people who love trash cinema. What's the plot of Battletruck, Nathan?
So you start off with like a voiceover. It's like a radio transmission. It's like after the oil wars.
The Mesopotamian Basin showed that radioactivity levels remain high. And with the oil fields in Arabia still burning, the world total reserves of petroleum have dropped even lower.
And then it gets more and more crackly, like the radio transmission. It keeps, like, your exposition at the start shouldn't be hard to hear. If I can fault anything at the start, I'm like, what? What's he saying?
I can pick up little details here and there, like pockets of the land being irradiated by nuclear fallout or only fuel being available for the government, but I can't really be sure, hey.
It's through like this muffled, it's like Bane over a two-way radio in like a cheap like supermarket giving exposition. You're like, what?
Food riots have continued into the third day, and martial law was declared for all of Greater Detroit.
I can't hear you.
Look, all you need to know is there's a massive truck roaming the wilderness as part of a warband convoy, and that thing is truly prepared for battle. It's pretty sturdy, which is really useful considering it's driven through nearly every small and fragile structure shown
yeah,
on screen.
Yeah. And I imagine it uses a hell of a lot of fuel considering it's got like, what, 40 tons of armor on it? Like, not the most efficient vehicle to be driving around in when fuels are like a very hard to get commodity.
No, not at all. But weirdly, the man behind the truck is pretty ruthlessly efficient. The leader of the warband is a fella named Colonel Straker, who is the main bad guy and someone you're supposed to dislike. But honestly, he's one of the most entertaining characters in the film.
Oh, he's awesome. And he like has these little throwaway lines like, well, we're doing what the generals couldn't do. Those, you know, and you're like, what? What are they doing? And you're like, he's obviously like a rogue group of soldiers and that have gone off on their own and made this battle truck and are now trying to rule the wasteland.
Oh, yeah, totally. He's interesting because he kind of believes he's doing the right thing to help the wasteland. If it's all under his control, then at least it's some kind of control, which leads to some hilariously blunt scenes.
Hey, boss! Caught these dirty just trying to sneak up on us.
What are you boys up to?
We live around here. What's it to you?
Well, that's fair enough. Shoot him!
I would say Straker's an awesome character, but his one Achilles heel is a woman named Corley.
Corley is an interesting one because the creative team behind the film are definitely trying to play coy with her. They don't really tell us the relationship between her and Straker, but they do tell us about her father.
He was a saint. Everybody loved him. We'd travel around and help people fix things. Then one morning he just didn't wake up. So I kept on going. That's what he would have wanted, I guess.
But the whole time I was watching this, I was like, Straker's definitely her father, and that's just a metaphorical death. And yep, that's what it was. So I can only imagine maybe Straker was more of a noble good guy who turned bad at some point.
Yeah, he's fall from grace sort of thing.
And he definitely is a bad guy, despite how noble he might think his cause is.
Who's in charge here?
Hey, wait a minute. You can't come in.
Who's in charge here?
But in short, Corley's had enough of her dad roaming the wasteland, stealing supplies and herding people to find fuel. So she decides to leave.
She escapes.
and she meets up with Hunter.
Oh yeah, our main protagonist, who is only really in the movie for like 20 minutes and has one of the most concise backstories ever put to celluloid.
Don't you ever get lonely up here?
Don't care much for people.
Did you fight in the wars?
Yep.
Bet you nobody ever bothers you up here.
Nope.
Fook me, that was fast.
And he's like, has like no dialogue, but rides a motorbike way too fast and you got someone on the back with no helmet on, like through the woods and stuff. And I was like, holy crap, dude, slow down. There's no one chasing you.
Honestly, I think he might be trying to escape some copyright lawyers, because I'm pretty sure this post-apocalyptic movie and character feel a little indebted to another very familiar and popular post-apocalyptic franchise. But I'm really struggling to put my finger on what it might be right now.
You were very lucky, weren't you?
Oh, yeah.
For a while.
Well, what do you mean?
Time up.
What?
Ah! But yeah, Hunter takes Corley to a town called Clearwater, which is a little ragtag community made up of people trying to live off the land. And she eventually becomes part of the town, but you know it's only time until Straker goes searching for her.
There's some cool stuff about it in that town, like the people are working together. There's like a blacksmith and there's like the inventor guy and they all got their own little jobs and what can you bring to the town sort of thing. I thought that was pretty cool.
Yeah, it's a town where everyone gets a say and everyone gets food and supplies by contributing what they can. And it kind of made me think of a George Romero movie like Day of the Dead, where you get two distinct worldviews conflicting, because our town is a perfect little commune while Straker and the Battletruck represent pretty much straight up fascism.
You can plant your taters, you can grow your sweet corn. But you will do this at the direction of, and for the purposes of, your leader. This ain't no democracy, kiddies.
Naturally, then, the Battletruck comes to Clearwater looking for Corley.
Yeah, the convoy makes no secret of their incoming arrival, and the town puts up a pretty good fight. But Corley has no choice but to escape and seek out Hunter for help. And while there's quite a few more twists and turns to the plot, it's about what you'd expect from this kind of film from here on out. Action, and lots of it. And something in particular that's just so outrageously awesome.
Are we talking about the battle bug at the end?
We're talking about the battle bug.
Oh my God, what a car.
There's only one way to beat a battle truck, and that's with a battle bug.
An armored Volkswagen Beetle that he crashes down a cliff and it rolls end over end. And then he just keeps driving like it was nothing at all. That was amazing. When that showed up, I was like, this movie just jumped up so high in how great it is. Like, I was cheering.
It's so on the nose, but I just love how a huge chunk of the town has to come together to build the battle bug so they can beat the bad guys. And Max learns to trust again and work with others. Wait, I mean Hunter. Why did I say Max?
Don't be a child.
There's so much great action in this film, though, especially in that last half when the battle bug comes into play.
He runs over a stuntman, too.
But they cut away, like, pretty quickly. Yeah, but it's like, I was like, that man's dead.
Because the driver can't see anything because it's all metal panels. He would have been so blind driving around.
Oh, like, I mean, obviously the stuntman was okay in the end, but man, it really gave me a jolt when I first saw it. And if that and the battle bug isn't ridiculous enough, Hunter and his motorbike are the reason the battle truck gets taken down.
Yeah, after they blow the back end of the truck open, he then rides his motorbike and jumps it into the truck. Wasn't the truck like chasing someone down? In the end, it's like the truck trying to get away from the dude on the bike. It was so good.
Yeah, it was so satisfying because throughout the whole movie, Straker is so cocky because of his battle truck and of course his big convoy.
We got a great big convoy rocking through the night. We got a great big convoy. Ain't she a beautiful sight?
So to see him on the run just works so well in the plot to tell you, you know, the tide has turned for this character. And of course, we have to end a movie like this on a big note, so I knew they were going to do something to destroy the truck, but I thought for ages it would slip off a cliff out of frame or something like that, you know, to avoid an actual explosion. But nope, this movie really delivers.
Oh man, does it deliver? What a shot. And then it's just like, and we're done.
Yeah. Like, yes. Oh, yeah. That, look, the movie's out about as quickly as it came in.
Yeah. She's like, Hunter, you going to stay with us? He's like, nah, gets on a horse. Yeah.
Which, like, kind of teased me for a sequel that I thought, you know, maybe they were going to do. But there was no sequel to this movie. But for a little bit, I was like, please come up with a title card saying Hunter will return in Battle Horse.
Okay, so we've been kind of skirting around this, but obviously this is a Mad Max ripoff, like shot. This is New Zealand Mad Max.
Yeah, and when we mean Mad Max, we're talking about the original Aussie film, not its sequel, The Road Warrior, because this film actually only came out a month or so after the release of The Road Warrior.
Oh, really? Because I was about to say, Road Warrior is the influential, like, people think Mad Max, it's Road Warrior they think of. It's very rarely Mad Max.
Yeah, absolutely. But the DNA of George Miller's seminal Ozploitation film is all over this one. And I guess I should clarify that even though this is a film made in New Zealand with a crew made up of mostly Kiwis, a lot of the funding and push came from America. It was only shot in New Zealand to take advantage of a tax break at the time. And a chunk of the funding actually came from the legendary B-movie producer Roger Corman.
Oh, okay.
Actually, we've reviewed his film Lords of the Deep, so maybe B-grade is being a little generous here. Maybe we should say more Z-grade sometimes.
Yeah, yeah, I was about to say, this is pretty... This looks even good for, like, a Roger Corman film.
I think a lot of that is thanks to the director Harley Cokeliss, who worked as a second unit director on Empire Strikes Back. He really treats the whole thing pretty seriously, despite an obviously low budget.
It was there, you know, back in Chicago, which is a city kind of webbed with highways, that I was just struck by the size of the vehicles, and I started being a lifelong science fiction fan. The notion of this story was kind of began there.
So would you recommend Battletruck, Nathan?
Oh, yeah, I'd recommend it. I definitely recommend it.
Yeah, I think it's a lot of fun. There's definitely some problems. Like, the Corley character is really inconsistent. She spends half the movie being nothing more than a cliched damsel in distress.
She's fainted.
Just like a woman.
Yet with nothing more than a little push, she becomes this murdering badass.
Hi, boys.
But yeah, even with some problems around the characterization, I'd still recommend this one. I know it's got American money behind it, but it's so good to see a film like this with a bit of a taste of New Zealand mixed in.
This is a great New Zealand, like, genre film for the time. There have been other great New Zealand movies that have come out, but I think for the time, this is a great film.
Oh yeah, it's so much fun. I mean, we should say it's never really going to reach the highbrow heights of Kiwi classics like The Piano or Whale Rider, or even the greatest New Zealand film of all time, which is directed by Peter Jackson, the director of the Lord of the Rings films. But no, I'm not talking about the Lord of the Rings films. I'm talking about the far superior Bad Taste.